Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship at New Church. You guys doing all right? Well, thanks for joining us today. Everyone who's here in person and all of our online friends. Today's going to be really special, you guys, because first we're going to send off two of our young men with God's blessing into the Army. That's happening this morning. We even have a special song for the occasion by Vaughn and Angel and David. And we're also starting a new message series. I'm really looking forward to that. It's called Defending Your Faith. It's not a mistake that you're here today. I know that God is going to have something for you this morning. So as we get started, let's read this verse out loud together. It's a different one, so you're going to have to pay attention. Let's read this together. In your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect. Let's pray as we get started today. Father in heaven, we quiet our hearts before you now. We have gathered in this place together as your church, as your people. Help us to put aside all of our distractions from the week, from the ride over, all the worries we brought in here with us this morning. Help us to focus on being here, to focus on giving you praise and honoring you and giving thanks for the lives you've given us. We ask that you would prepare our hearts to hear your word, that you would help us to hear the promises of Jesus, that you would teach us to believe in him as our only Lord and Savior, and help us to grow in our faith, help us to become more faithful as your people. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And we continue in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Let's stand up and sing together.
and our defender, suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in you. I believe you rose again. I believe that you. In the virgin birth, I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe.
Thank you.
all my sorrows, Jesus is better. Make my heart believe in every victory. Jesus is better. Make my heart believe. Than any comfort, Jesus is better. Make my heart believe. More than all riches, Jesus is better. Make my heart believe. And our souls declaring, Jesus is better. Make my heart believe. And our song eternal, Jesus is better. Make my heart believe. Glory, glory, we have no other King but Jesus, Lord of all.
Come on.
Glory, glory, we have no other King but Jesus, Lord of all. Faultless to stand before
So this morning we have the privilege to bless two of our young men as they leave their homes and join the United States Army. So Jacob, Kelske, and Chase Stanley, would you guys stand, like right where you are, just stand up. All right, remain standing, please, and take these words from Scripture to heart. Psalm 144:1. Blessed be the Lord, my rock, who trains my hands for war and my fingers for battle. You know, the Christian life is often compared to the life of a soldier. In Ephesians chapter 6, we're told to put on the full armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. Soldiers came to talk to John the Baptizer, and they asked what they should do to follow the Lord. And it's significant that he did not tell them to stop being soldiers. In Luke chapter 3, it says, soldiers also asked him, and what shall we do? And he said to them, do not extort money from anyone by threats or by false accusation, and be content with your wages. And about the use of force, we're told this in Romans 13, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid. For he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. But the world is a dangerous place. And Jesus said in John 15, greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. Love has to always be the driving motivation behind everything you do. Not revenge, not anger. James 1:20, it says, the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. There's going to be a lot of times when this isn't going to be easy, guys. In 2 Timothy 2:3, it says, share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. And as the men went off to battle, the head of Israel's army, Joshua, this is what he said to him. He said, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened. Do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. God will be with you. Jesus echoed this in the Great Commission when he said, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I invite everybody to pray with me. If you could extend your hand out to them. If you're nearby, put a hand on them. Let's pray that God would bless them. Almighty God, gracious Father, the promise of your presence is sure and it's certain to us. Be with your servants, Jacob Kelske and Chase Stanley, and lead them forward in your peace. Guide them and direct them. Protect and defend them. Grant them your Holy Spirit, that they may remain steadfast in their faith and come at last to eternal life in your heavenly kingdom. Lord of hosts, Lord of the armies of heaven, stretch forth your almighty arm to protect and strengthen Jacob and Chase, who begin their service in the armed forces of our country. Bless their training so they can apply themselves with all diligence. Support them in times of war and in times of peace, and keep them from any kind of evil. Give them courage and loyalty, and grant that in all things they will serve honestly without reproach. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's thank these guys preemptively.
All right, God's word says, everything that we have has come from him, and we give him only what he first gave to us. 1 Chronicles chapter 29. Good morning. I'm Peter. It's good to see everybody here today. This is the time when those of us who call New Church home give back a portion of what God has given us as a part of our weekly worship. We believe that everything that we have and are has come from God. Blessed, so that we can then be a blessing to others. And it's your faithful giving that makes it possible for us to do God's work here at New Church and continue doing his ministry. So thank you for being a part of that with us. The first $100 of our offering today will go towards the Pregnancy Help Center, which is a local ministry that programs to help people who are faced with an unplanned pregnancy. Let's pray. So good and gracious Father, it is with thankful hearts that we give back to you from what you have first given to us. Receive these tithes and these offerings as an act of worship. In the name of Jesus, who gave everything for us, bless this week's offering so that it will be enough. Amen. It's easy to give from your computer or smartphone. Just go to newchurch.love/give. If you haven't already set up automated monthly or weekly giving, this is a great time to do that. And it's super important that we continue to be faithful in our tithes and offerings during this time. If you're a guest, either in person or with us on the web, please let us know how we can be praying for you by going to newchurch.love/info and fill out the digital guest card. Thanks.
Hello. So this song reminds me of a verse from Romans 7, where it says, I don't really understand myself. I want to do what is right, but I don't. Instead, I do what I hate. We are always at war with ourselves. Says he wants to as well, but he's just a liar. I believe it all. There's nothing I won't understand. going to let go of that wire. He says that he will, but he's just a liar. Two birds and a wire. One tries to fly away, and the other watches him close from that wire. He says he wants.
Christians are nothing but hypocrites.
God doesn't care what you believe. Is the Christian faith true?
Is Jesus who we claim to be?
Logic, science, and morality have their foundation in God's truth.
A person must justify how they can know what they know.
Only faith in Christ makes sense out of the human experience.
Morning again.
Morning.
It is so good to see you guys all here. Come together, to gather around the promises of God and to gather around His Word. It's very encouraging. Let's pray as we get started with this message today. Father in heaven, we ask that you would open our hearts to hear your Word today, that we would be challenged and that we would be inspired and we would be comforted. In Jesus' name. Amen. So Kim and I have been part of a lot of different churches over the years. Different sizes, different denominations, high church and low church. Churches that met in cathedrals and chapels and metal buildings. Cafeterias, houses, apartments, even gyms. And all of those churches, they were made up of people who, for some reason or other, wanted to come together with other Christians in a church setting where there's some kind of preaching or teaching from the Bible, some singing, prayer, and other worship activities. Now, some of these congregations were made up of people who really knew their Bibles. They could have meaningful conversations about theology, the implications that their faith has for how to view culture and politics and entertainment, relationships, anything else. Other congregations were mostly made up of people who only had the most basic knowledge or interest in those kind of things. They would say they were Christian, but what they knew about the Bible didn't get much beyond John 3:16 and Psalm 23. And sometimes that was because they were new to the faith. But most of the time it's because they weren't really that interested. Ever since I was a teenager, I wanted to go into ministry so I could spend as much of my life as possible helping people see their need for Jesus. Because I wasn't brought up in the church. I wasn't brought up in the faith. And I wanted to tell people like me, like my family, that they need to be saved. Saved from a false view of God, from a false view of themselves.
Because without faith in Jesus, life is meaningless and cruel, hopeless. I wanted to not only show people that there's no hope of eternal life outside of Jesus, but there's no intellectual hope of making sense out of the human existence, like in the here and now. And I've met very few Christians who really understand that. Most of the church people that I've known over the years, they've got their faith so compartmentalized from the rest of their life that they barely see how it's supposed to make any difference in the world. So not surprisingly, they don't make much of a difference in the world. Add to that the fact that many of the Christians who do know their Bible and theology, they either just keep it to themselves because they don't want to argue with people, or they like arguing a little too much, and they push people away from the truth with aggression and anger, cruelty. Like last month, Kim and I spent a couple days in Galveston, and there was this guy who thought it was a good idea to stand at a busy intersection holding up a sign that said, "Homosexual sex is sin." Why did he think that was a good idea? What good could possibly come from that? Does he think some homosexual person who doesn't know anything about the love and grace of Jesus, they're going to see his sign and they're going to think to themselves, "Oh, Christians think what I'm doing with my life is sin. Huh, I should probably just stop being gay then. I'm so thankful to that kind and brave man who gave up his afternoon to set me straight." It's ridiculous. It's not helpful at all. That kind of thing only pushes people further away from God. Now, I haven't known that many people with literal stand on the street corner obnoxious signs, but I've known way too many Christians who are quick to throw Bible verses at people like hand grenades, ready to throw down at the first indication that someone might have an opinion that doesn't line up with their opinion of Scripture. And I will admit to you, my friends, I've been that guy. The majority of Christians that Kim and I have known over the years, they're either too aggressive or they're too passive, one way or the other. They either know their Bibles and they want to shove them down people's throat, or they don't really know that much about doctrine and theology, so they just keep their faith to themselves. Which one do you tend to be? The key verse for this series is 1 Peter 3:15. We read it earlier. "In your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect." So in your hearts, meaning your thoughts, your feelings, the very center of who you are, in your heart, honor Christ the Lord as holy. Keep his name holy in your thoughts, in your words, in the things you do, in everything you say, everything you do, keep the name of Jesus holy. Like the prayer, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. May I keep your name holy." Live a life that is so different from the world of unbelievers that at school and at work and at home and everywhere you go, you stand out as a person who begs these kind of questions. People see you and they wonder, why do you have hope when everything looks so hopeless? What makes you able to face all the madness of the world with that attitude? I mean, everyone else is biting everyone's head off. Everyone else is tearing everybody down. Everyone else is freaking out about which lives matter, whether global warming is caused by something we're doing wrong, to mask or to not mask, Trump or Biden. Do my kids have a future in this world? Is this all there is to life? See, there has to be something different about you, my Christian friends. You have something else going on. So what is it? What is the hope that you've got that everyone else seems to be missing out on? And then, when they ask, you got to be prepared to give an answer, a defense, a reason for the hope that you have, for the faith you have. But how do you do that? Like, with arrogance and condescension? With sarcasm and impatience? With anger and petty character attacks? A little side of snark? No. God says to do it with gentleness and respect. When you're asked to defend your faith, you got to be ready and you've got to be prepared to do it gently and respectfully. And why is this important? I want you to realize it's the only thing that's important. When I started New Church about 5.5 years ago now, I did it for one reason. I wanted to build a local church that wasn't just playing church. I wanted it to be some place where people who believed in Jesus but were tired of all the religious games that people were playing in other churches, a place where they could come and be part of something different, something real. I wanted it to be a place where people who were hurt by other religious people could come for healing, get a chance to start over with people who understand grace and mercy. I wanted it to be a place where people learned how to follow Jesus, a place where people are serious about learning what it means to be a disciple, a disciplined student of the Christian faith. And more than anything else, I wanted New Church to be a place where a local church gathered together and were trained to have conversations with people outside the church about what hope in Jesus looks like. So I thought, where do these kind of conversations happen? These life-changing, raw, honest, get down to the meaning of life conversations. Where do they happen? Because they don't usually happen in church, do they? They usually happen over a meal with friends or sharing a cup or a pint, usually later in the evening when our defenses are down. So I thought, why not have a church that just meets at a restaurant or a bar, someplace that could be open all week long for food and drinks? And then the church would gather in that same space for worship on Sundays. So, man, that's what we've been trying to do since day one here. We want to grow enough so that we can save up enough money to get our own place where we can have a restaurant, a pub with space for us to meet on Sunday. And then the rest of the week, it would be a place where people would come together to eat and drink, a place to have those real, honest, difficult conversations about life and faith. So that's what we're trying to do. But I gotta wonder, how can we get ready for that ministry? Are we prepared to give an answer for the hope that's within us? Are we ready to sit down with confused and misguided people? Are we ready to give a defense for our faith without getting defensive, without getting angry? When people bring up the typical criticisms that those who are outside the church have against Christianity, are you going to know what to say? I mean, not to win an argument, but to overcome their objections so you can invite them in. Because we need to be. That's what God has called us, New Church, to be. A church on the front lines, making disciples, defending our faith. Not the kind of church that shows up now and then just to play some religious game, but a church that knows the Bible and theology and doctrine and isn't content to hoard those treasures for ourselves, but instead be a church that loves people, loves the truth, and is armed with the truth. You know, much of America has lost its faith. People used to talk about the United States as being a Christian nation. And then, for a long time, people talked about it being a post-Christian nation. But when I look at the upcoming generation, the generation that was mostly brought up outside the church by parents who really only have the most basic understanding of Christian theology and doctrine, if they have any understanding at all, I think we can think of this next generation as mostly pre-Christian. It's almost like we're starting over, like in first century Rome. Except unlike Rome, who had never heard of Jesus, we got a bunch of people who think he's a joke, or worse. A lot of people think having faith in Jesus is something bad, like a weakness, something dangerous even, a threat. You know, in the early years of the church, just after Jesus had risen from the dead and told his followers to go into all the world making disciples everywhere they went, the days when the New Testament was being written, we've got a lot of examples where they had to defend their faith. Let's look at a couple of those. On the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, Peter stands up and he defends his faith in Jesus to a hostile crowd of Jews in Jerusalem. He explained how the Messiah had to be crucified. He even said they were the ones that did it. You nailed him to a cross and killed him. But then he said this: but God raised him from the horrors of death and raised him back to life, for death could not keep him in its grip. So let everyone in Israel know for certain that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, to be both Lord and Messiah. In Acts 9, we have a newly converted Saul, a guy who had dedicated his life to crushing Christianity and killing the followers of Jesus. The dude had a come to Jesus moment, and he started preaching about Jesus and defending this newfound faith in Jesus. Verse 22 says, Saul's preaching became more and more powerful, and the Jews in Damascus couldn't refute his proofs that Jesus was indeed the Messiah. The book of Acts, it's pretty much a record of people defending their faith, having conversations with people, and changing the world. Saul was an educated Jew. He knew his Bible, but he was also a Roman citizen who was educated in all the philosophies of the Greeks and the Romans. The first part of his ministry was to the Jews. That's the first part of the book of Acts. And he defended his faith using the Old Testament, using the history of Israel. But then the second half of the book of Acts, it focuses on his ministry to non-Jews, to Romans and Greeks, the Gentiles. And there is a big change in how he approaches ministry to people who didn't know theology and scripture. First, he started using his Roman name instead of his Jewish name. He had dual citizenship. So that's why he stopped going by Saul and started going by Paul, because Paul was his legal Roman name. He also started preaching to all of these unbelievers by pointing out cracks in the Greek and Roman worldview. And then he would do that before he pointed them to God the Creator and Jesus the Lord and Savior. In Acts 17, Paul's in Athens. And it says he was deeply troubled by all the idols he saw everywhere in the city. He went to the synagogue to reason with the Jews and the God-fearing Gentiles. And he spoke daily in the public square to all who happened to be there. He also had a debate with some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers, telling them about Jesus and the resurrection. But they had a lot of trouble tracking with him. They thought he sounded like a crazy person. Resurrection. At least until he built a bridge to their worldview and he started talking about the unknown God. Because they had so many gods. They had so many idols and altars and statues. Paul said, "I can see that you're very religious. I mean, you even have a statue for the God you don't know about." He said, that's the God he's trying to tell them about. Jesus is that God you don't know about. He's the God who made the world and everything in it. And since he's the Lord of heaven and earth, he doesn't live in man-made temples, and human hands can't serve his needs. He doesn't have any needs. He's the one who gives life and gives breath to everything. He's the one who satisfies everyone else's needs. See, right there, that's how it's done. That's Christ Kwon Do. That's how you defend your faith, my friends. You got to find the crack in the person's belief system, in their worldview. You got to find it, and you got to use that crack to point them to faith in Jesus. And look, if their belief system isn't based on the God of the Bible, who was ultimately revealed in Jesus Christ, then I promise you, there is going to be a gaping crack in their worldview. There's no truth outside of truth that has God as the foundation. Anything that's true is based on God's truth. Unbelievers, they have to borrow from our Christian worldview, or they can't make sense out of the human experience at all. Now, they don't know that, of course. That's why Jesus sent us into the world to tell them. See, everything from logic, science, justice, to morality and love, compassion, human dignity, all of those things have their foundation in God's truth. And I have known very few Christians who really get this. The only worldview that provides the philosophical framework that's needed for reasoning and knowledge in any field is the worldview that Jesus gave us in his life and in his teaching. all truth is Christ's truth. All the truth is His. It's all subject to Him. Anything we think might be true, it's got to be tested against what He has told us. Like it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, we destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God. And we take every thought captive to obey Christ. Think about it. Just think about this. If the universe is just a random, constantly changing collection of atoms and chaos, if the human mind is just a bunch of chemicals and electrical charges, if there's no God behind any of this, no creator, no purposeful design, then there's no meaning. There's no hope. Love is just an illusion. Sparks and chemicals. Compassion and empathy, they're nothing but a distraction from survival in this violent, chaotic smashing of random material and flesh and bone. Even survival itself, what's the point? It's futile. It's meaningless. And people say they believe that stuff, but no one can live like that. No one can live and laugh and love and hope in that empty void of darkness. To make sense out of life, they've got to build their worldview on borrowed concepts, because they have to believe in human dignity and love and purpose and logic. They have to believe in a consistent universe. And those things only exist in a world that was created by a God who made people in His image and has a plan and a purpose for how they live their lives. Reality only makes sense when it's understood through the lens of the Christian faith. So I'm going to need your help. If we're going to be the church that God has called us to be, there's no way I can do this by myself. The world needs Jesus. People desperately need to put their faith in Him. Man, before they burn everything down with all these acts of misguided stupidity and violence. And most Christians aren't going to help us because they don't know enough about what they believe or how to defend their faith. Because to defend faith, I mean, we have to have faith to defend. And maybe these words have pierced your heart. Maybe you're wondering what you're supposed to do now. Well, this is how Peter finished that message to all those believers in Acts chapter 2. He said, Each of you must repent of your sins and turn to God and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is to you, to your children, and to those far away, all who have been called by the Lord our God. And then Peter continued preaching for a long time, strongly urging all of his listeners, save yourselves from this crooked generation. Over the next few weeks, we're going to spend our time here together learning how to defend our faith, why it's important, what we need to do to be ready, and some practical ways to actually do it. So here's an exercise that I would like us all to do over this next week. Here's an exercise. You might want to write this down. I want you to notice all the times that people who don't confess to be Christians have to borrow from a worldview that believes in love, human dignity, compassion, justice, and all those things that only make sense if there's a loving God who created us. I want you to notice those things when you're watching TV or movies or reading, even when you're listening to people make political promises. Notice those things and then email them to me. Email them to me at frank@frankhart.com. I want you to open your eyes and see the cracks in the very weak foundations of the people who don't believe in Jesus. I'm going to end with this paraphrase of Philippians 1, 7 and 16. You share with me the special favor of God because of Jesus, both in defending and confirming the truth of the gospel. I've been appointed to defend the faith, and so have you. Amen. As the band's coming back, let's pray. Father in heaven, we humbly hear your word today. We repent of our apathy and our anger, and we turn back to you. Incline our hearts to keep this word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand up and sing about our faith.
Jesus in Mark 12 repeated what was said in the Decalogue. He said, you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And you know, Christians in the West, you know, we're kind of generally working on loving the Lord our God with all our heart and our soul and our strength. But we're kind of weak on the mind part, you know, which is, in our culture especially, a glaring error to make. So in these weeks to come, I hope you'll take seriously, you know, the urge to remember and study and do the things that's necessary so that you can be obedient to the word and make an answer to those who wonder why your hope is. It would probably be helpful if you knew why you had hope. I'm just saying, you know, from a mental perspective. So take advantage of those resources, guys. So now's the time when we pray. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And now we're going to pray for the needs of the church. And you should do that too, not just me. So let's pray together. Lord God, Heavenly Father, since we cannot stand before You relying on anything we've done, help us trust in Your abiding grace and live according to Your word. Through Jesus Christ, Your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with You in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Ask, Lord, that You would move us to serve You with all that we are, as You have commanded us to do. Give us the strength and the gumption. Cause us to overcome our laziness, mental or otherwise, and apply ourselves to obeying Your word. We also lift up to You, Lord, the various needs of our church. We lift up those who are facing medical procedures or those who are sick. We specifically pray for, we pray for Michelle and Oliver and Mary and Joan and Carol and Dan and Brooke and Bryson and Rob, Lord. And we also lift up to You those who are having relationship problems and ask that You would reconcile. We lift up those who are facing financial challenges, for the people needing jobs. We ask You provide for Your people in the midst of all this silliness. We lift up those who are tired or sad. Lord, we ask You to be their joy. And we lift up Texas and the United States. Pray that our leaders would take seriously the hope of the gospel and that our nation could be a light for all the nations, and that, God, that You would call all the leaders of all the world and all the peoples to serve You. We pray for NewChurch and for Your church throughout the world, that we'd be faithful in the mission that You have called us to do. If there's any here this morning who have not repented of their sin and have not confessed their need of a Savior, haven't believed on Jesus' name, we pray that You would cause them to hear the gospel today, turn away from death, and begin to walk in Your new life. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Now let us praise the Lord Jesus has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the Lord bless you, may He keep you, may He shine His face upon you, grant you His favor, give you His peace. May He pour His grace upon you. You have been blessed to be a blessing. You have been blessed to be a blessing. So walk in His love. Thank you.
face upon you, grant you his favor, give you his peace, may he pour his grace upon you. You have been blessed to be a blessing. You have been blessed to be a blessing. So walk in his love, walk in his love, go in peace.
Well, thank you guys very much for being here. If you could have a seat. We have a few announcements this morning, and Peter's going to take care of those for us right now.
Okay. Thank you for joining us today, for being here. And we had a few quick announcements before you run away. You can always go to newchurch.love/info to find out everything that's going on New Church Base. Kemper and Ryan's Zoom classes are happening today, so go to newchurch.love/events, and you can find out all of the meeting info. If you've been coming to New Church and you know that this is your church home, it's time for you to become a member. So please see Pastor Frank and tell him that you want to talk about membership. All right, Youth Night is this Wednesday. We're going to start at 7 p.m. and we're going to meet at In-N-Out. Yes. Adults are welcome. Yes, you guys can. I'm not going to keep you away from In-N-Out. So do please join us in that. We'll be done about 8:15, 8:30. All right, we always stream a raw feed of the Sunday service, but there's also an edited version that goes out somewhere around 5 p.m. Maybe God pierced your heart today. Maybe God is saying, you know what? I need to put this out there. Find that edited version. Put it out on the web. You can go to newchurch.love and do that. It is so good to see everyone here today. Please make sure you grab all your personal belongings. We need to pack up and get out as quick as we can, so please move your conversations out to the parking lot. Keep an eye on your kiddos. We'll be back here next week, but as always, go to newchurch.love and watch for updates. Remember to be friendly and greet each other. Think about the folks that weren't able to be here. Reach out to them. Say hi. Say we love you. We miss you. And we will see you guys next week.